Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences. Welcome to Causes. The University of the District of Columbia is the only public university in the District of Columbia and the only exclusively urban land-grant university in the United States. In the proud tradition of the land-grant universities, we serve a dual purpose: to offer academic programs on our campuses and community outreach programs that build economic capacity and improve the quality of life for people and organizations in the District of Columbia. And speaking of quality of life, and of life in general, there is hardly anything that impacts us as much as our water. 70% of our bodies are made up of water, and 70% of our planet is water too. And water is tricky. There can be too little of it and too much of it. And neither one of these scenarios is particularly good. With me today on this edition of Causes TV is Dr. Norman Stoller, immediate past president of the American Water Resources Association National Capital Section and a member of the Water Resources Research Consortium that includes the University of the District of Columbia and its Water Resources Research Institute. Joining Dr. Stoller is my colleague, Dr. Tolesa Dexisa, director of the Water Resources Research Institute and the Environmental Testing Laboratory here at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome, gentlemen. Norman, let's start with you. Tell us about the consortium. What is it all about?
Well, basically, the consortium is a very informal mm-hmm. network. And the term consortium sounds very, very formal. But basically, it consists of the academic institutions in the area, of which UDC is a primary example. Mm-hmm. And it consists of government agencies, mm-hmm. other academics, professional engineering groups. And basically, we come together mm-hmm. to work on water resources issues. Uh-huh. And the touchstone of the year is our annual Water Resources mm-hmm. Symposium, mm-hmm. which we hold thanks to your hospitality at UDC year after year.
Yeah. And that's a really interesting group. It brings together, as you said, private sector, public sector, academic institutions. What's sort of the geographical reach of the group?
Well, basically, we're the district, Maryland, and Virginia. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's about as far as we go. Beyond that, you're dealing with the national organization.
Okay, but that's quite a sizable chunk of space, right? And a very diverse one. You have coastal regions in there, you have, when you get to the southern part of the state of Virginia, you've got more mountainous areas, so really interesting distribution, geographic distribution.
Absolutely, and the diversity of the topics that we talk about mm-hmm. and work with reflects that, uh-huh. that diversity.
So give us some examples, Tolesa. What is the topic for the Water Resources Conference, for example?
Yeah, for example, this year our topic is a resilient solution for water resource or water management mm-hmm. in urban environment, which includes actually advance in research, policy, finance, and technology. Those are the areas that we are covering this. And last year we did flooding, mm-hmm. infrastructure, aging infrastructure, maintaining those kind of things. Every year we have really the current problem and also future scenario that we should tackle related to water. That's the area we cover.
Well, resilience is quite an emerging topic.
Yeah.
So what does it mean in terms of water management?
You know, as most of people notice, actually, water is when it is too small or too high, mm-hmm. which cause flooding, or too low, people really scramble over water, fight over water. So to avoid this, the community, the society need to build a resilience toward this, what to do or to prepare for those kind of mm-hmm. situation. Mm-hmm. Like when it is overflow water, how you actually save water and keep it when it is no water. Water is, we got the same amount of water every year. The problem is the distribution. Mm-hmm. It's not uniformly distributed over the year. Mm-hmm. So it's up to us to live. How do we smartly adjust or adapt ourselves so that we don't be affected and be resilient to small water, little water, or too much water?
So resilience is planning ahead. A lot of it is planning ahead,
right? That's correct.
And
absolutely.
Anticipating when might we experience drought, when might we experience flooding events, and how we can level it out.
That's correct.
So that seems like you are working with a lot of different fields, right? Probably tell us some of those. Hydrology, engineering,
geology, ecology, biology, economics. Mm-hmm. Who did I miss?
Yeah. Literally all the discipline, because water is really interdisciplinary. Mm-hmm. Water needs all the fields. Mm-hmm. Because all the fields need water. Mm-hmm. So there is no really any, like, even the musicians telling the story about water
in
a very nice way, poetry.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting. You know, and we're not particularly good at that in academia, aren't we? We usually have our niches, right? So it seems to me the consortium is a really important place for you to carry on those conversations across different disciplines. So what are some of the research collaborations that have come out of the consortium?
Yeah, yes, currently actually the most, like in DC area, for example, the main issue that we are addressing is how to actually mitigate this combined sewer overflow, which is green infrastructure approach to reduce the impact of, you know, those runoff from the street, which is like combined sewer overflow is really for every old city is a problem, which means like us, small as 1 inch of rain, there's a significant number of combined sewer overflow in DC area. That's why we can't swim or fish in DC waterways because of this combined sewer overflow. Mm-hmm. To address that, we need to both green and the green infrastructure. So a lot of green infrastructure research is like green roof performance tests and designing it, and also how to pervious pavement, even in some part of the city there is pervious pavement, try to replace those, reducing the runoff. Those are one area of the research that we going around the DC area. Mm-hmm. The other is the flood. Flooding is an issue everywhere, but there are national level research initiatives. Also, we addressed this area in the beginning of our annual water symposium. So the diverse water quality is always there, which is like including lead in water, nutrient in water, including the fish emerging contaminant in Anacostia, Potomac River, which is fish tumor in Potomac, how to address that. There is a legacy contaminant in Potomac or Anacostia, how to address that, should we clean all that. Those are research areas that need to be.
So there really, there seem to be two very distinct types of issues with water. Yeah. One is more sort of the quantity of it, and how do we manage that, and the other is more the quality aspects, right? So when it comes to the quantity, Norm, what are some of the strategies that we use, let's say, in an urban area to prevent flooding?
Basically, flooding is in this area is very localized. Mm-hmm. I mean, the district, like the downtown District of Columbia, D.C., has its own unique problems. Mm-hmm. D.C. was built in a very low, marshy area. And if you look back at some of the old maps of D.C., you see canals all over the place and rivers. Well, these canals and rivers have been covered over, but we still have the same problems. When there's too much rainfall, you get flooding. Mm-hmm. There is a Corps of Engineers project. There's a little levee along the tidal basin. Most people don't notice it, but it's there, and it's supposed to protect us against the 100-year level storm. And then, of course, one of the things that when Talisa was mentioning the quality quantity, the other thing that's happening is that the environment, the climate, is changing around us. So what we used to think of as some kind of cycle that we can rely on to all the time, that's changing, and that makes the job tougher. Years ago, the term was stationarity is no longer with us. That the things are not going to be constant as they were before. So it's harder to plan around the issues, around solving the issues that Talisa was speaking about.
So we get more severe storm events and more gaps between storm events. Oh, what does it look like? And so that makes it much more difficult to kind of level it out, because your past experience no longer is reliable data. So you mentioned the levees. So say a little more. I mean, it's kind of common knowledge in the DC area that particularly when you get to Georgetown, some of the downtown areas, that those were swamps at one point. So now we've built buildings on top of it and roads and sidewalks and stuff. What happens with the water?
Well, the water has to go somewhere.
So it's still there.
It's still there, and eventually it's going to make its way into the tidal basin and into the Potomac River. But it's going to go past or over or around or through or underneath the structures, the roads, the buildings that we placed on the land.
And simply because we don't see it doesn't mean it's not there. Stay with us. My guests and I will return after this short break.
I would call UDC my saving grace. One thing that makes UDC so unique is that it encompasses all the definitions of what diversity means, not just in terms of racial diversity, but in terms of socioeconomic background.
But here at UDC, this is not your typical HBCU. We have a lot of different populations and international students and students such as me who are single parents. So I've met several different backgrounds, diverse people, religions, different majors, different age groups, tax brackets that all come here cumulatively to all achieve the same thing, and that's success.
Being at an HBCU has been a great experience for me. It's a really remarkable thing to see such diversity. It makes such a difference to me personally to be in an environment with such a broad range of students from all over the world.
So far, I've realized that UDC has a strong sense of community. And everything we do here, I feel like we're doing it as a team. And it's just a really nurturing environment, and it's just helping me focus in and realize what I want to do in my life.
I do enjoy the interpersonal relationships that you get to build amongst your peers, the faculty and the staff.
I enjoy being in a classroom with fewer students because I feel like the professor pays attention to me.
I know all my teachers personally, which has given me a lot of opportunities. I might even be working with one of my professors on research papers, which means I can be published in my second year of college, which is huge.
You get to do your own research. You work one-on-one with your professor, publishing scientific papers with just you and your professor together. You are actually learning techniques and, you know, skills that can prepare you for the rest of your life.
I feel like with the quality of education I am receiving here, I can become who I've always wanted to be.
I am I'm talking with Dr. Norman Stahler, immediate past president of the American Water Resources Association National Capital Section, and Dr. Talessa Dexisa, director of the Water Resources Research Institute here at the University of the District of Columbia. So we were just talking about this difference between quality aspects and quantity aspects. Are there different fields that are associated with that? It seems to me, you know, when I think about managing water fluctuations, water quantity, absorption, I think of the Corps of Engineers. So who are some of the other disciplines that are very involved in that, or some of the other agencies that are very involved in this aspect of managing the quantity of water?
I think that managing the quantity of water involves all sectors. For example, in controlling flooding, it involves everyone. Mm-hmm. Like for example, flash flood. Flash flood is the most challenging now.
That sounds pretty bad, yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't give you much time. So you need to prepare in advance, exercise, mm-hmm. and then know what to do when it happens.
So we actually practice that, what to do in flash floods?
Yes, like emergency preparedness plans as a city, as a community, you need to have that, because on that day, you have to know who is making a call. Uh-huh. So it's all like who's the commander in chief on that day. Mm-hmm. It goes from the local authority to all federal level mm-hmm. to be coordinated. So because it is not done in only local. So it like has to be coordinated. It's a coordinated effort. Mm-hmm. So everybody's involved in that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there are different level of engagement mm-hmm. when it comes to managing water. Mm-hmm. If that's managing life, I mean saving life and the property damage.
Yeah.
So that's just an example. And the other is like when it comes to quality, mm-hmm. like, okay, when it comes, okay, one city affected by quality, like not properly treated or misused, then it involves the laws, the policy, and, you know, mm-hmm. people litigation. So that involves mm-hmm. our environmental law, whatever mm-hmm. current law, mm-hmm. practitioners should be ready how to address that issue. So we need finance, we need policy, we need lawyers, and also this humanity area also. The social mm-hmm. scientists mm-hmm. need to be also involved. How to, okay, after the disaster,
yeah.
who will be restoring the community, coordinating the community. Those, it involves actually all the discipline. Mm-hmm. That's what it means.
So what do we need to know as consumers? If we have, you know, we're not an agency, mm-hmm. we're not a university, but I'm a resident of the district. What is it that I need to know about water?
Okay, you really, one thing that most of the people don't know is because they go to their tap water, they always get water.
Yeah.
They never realize when they just go that and when is the time that they really, there is no water.
Uh-huh. Remember, yeah, we expect it to be there.
The one thing that you know as a consumer, remember about that. There are other parts of the world that travel like days to get to the water
and
that
all
is
the infrastructure
not even
behind that tap. Mm.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And second is how that water. Water comes from the ocean to the city for free by just water cycle, but it doesn't come to your home for free mm-hmm. and spec. So this aging infrastructure is part of the concern if you want to continue enjoy low price mm-hmm. of tap water, which is the cheapest as compared to bottled water, and how to maintain that. That's mm-hmm. one, two things as a consumer. Plus, be aware of how to manage the quality, like when do you be concerned, like mm-hmm. what quality you are concerned. Be aware of the what is in it.
So when we're told not to run the garden hose and irrigate our lawns, we should listen to that, huh?
Yes. Uh-huh. And you should not use, like, there are water that come from your roof. You can use a rain barrel, collect those and use that for gardening. Uh-huh. Don't use chlorinated treated water for uh-huh. irrigation because it can change your soil chemistry mm-hmm. as well. It's not good to use clean, purified water for irrigation. That's not like remembering those who has no water, clean water. Mm-hmm. So be knowledgeable about this is as a role of the consumer.
So we expect to just turn the faucet and there it is, but it would be good if we remembered all the stuff, as you said, Norm, all the infrastructure behind getting it to our faucets in our homes.
And then there's the infrastructure involved after the water leaves our homes, after we have used it. Mm-hmm. And of course, that water is of different quality, as Celeste was saying, it's a different quality when it leaves our home, and then it has to be treated in some way before it goes back into the river and back into the ocean to continue the cycle. Mm-hmm. That's one of the topics that we will discuss at our symposium coming up, is the innovative methods that are being used on the water treatment and the management of water wayside. Uh-huh. And what we'll find out is how innovative it is and also how expensive it is. Uh-huh. And somebody has to pay.
Yeah.
And you're going to pay for what you drink. And you're going to pay for for the treatment of what happens after you drink it and use it in your household.
So you mentioned one strategy, Telesa, to kind of quote unquote get off the grid a little bit, right? We can capture rainwater actually as consumers. So that's a useful strategy if I have a yard or if I have a...
Yeah, use that. Like, you know, some bottled water is the same as tap water.
Yeah.
So which means when you are using tap water for irrigation, you are using like actually tap bottled
drinking water.
Drinking
right?
water yeah. for irrigating water. So using the rain barrel means collecting that also address the runoff from the impervious layer, means reduce the impact of the runoff from the street, from the roof, on the pipe that is under the ground for transporting our sewer system. Uh-huh. So it is has a dual purposes. Uh-huh. And the other thing is like really in the most really an asset for the developed urban system, which is the treatment, wastewater treatment technology. Many countries who has known that such a technology is not sustainable. Those cities that have very innovative, advanced treatment plants, they enjoy this like no impact of such a waste or contaminated site. Mm-hmm. So this is like we took it for granted.
So we're really in a very privileged position here in the United States and here in Washington, D.C., right? Mm-hmm. We have a very innovative water treatment system, very elaborate structures, but many countries are not as fortunate as we are in terms of the water quality they get. We expect to turn the faucet on and it's actually drinking water quality. Yeah. So there is a lot of planning and a lot of, you know, a lot of research that goes behind it. But you said it also comes at a price tag.
Yeah.
So that's what we pay in our water bills?
Yes. Mm-hmm. It includes
the inflow and the outflow.
Both the inflow and outflow. The outflow.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. That's a good way of...
So what can we do to... I mean, you mentioned capturing water is one strategy. Mm-hmm. Anything else? I mean, I always think of the outflow too, right? Mm-hmm. Is there a way to capture things that we can do in our households?
You know, the one thing that we are doing as a research, and even some other city, means reusing the gray water. Mm-hmm. Means the water that is not connected to the sewer. It means not holy water, but the water that you used for like washing dishes. Yeah. You can reuse it by treating minor treatment, filtering, and make sure there is no much salt in it.
Yeah.
So you can reuse that.
So not the water from your toilet, right?
No.
But the water from the dishes or the bathtub
For the reason of pathogen infectious diseases, we want to avoid that possible contamination. So don't mess up with the toilet, but you can treat that one, the gray part, and reuse it for the others. Many cities that are not like water rich in DC area, the other rich city actually is becoming a business for some city. Actually, start selling water, reused water.
Well, you know, we've heard some pretty alarming news about water. For example, Cape Town is running out of water within a span of a month, right? Are there other crisis areas like that? That sounds pretty serious when you're simply saying there is no more water. You can turn the tap, but there is no more water. That's awesome.
Every year you can look at a global map, and it's usually, choose your color, red, and you see all of these red areas all over the world. Cape Town is just one example. The Middle East, Asia with the melt, which in certain areas, which depends on the melting of the glaciers into the rivers. You know, that's changing. So there are all kinds of areas that we have to think of, geographic areas that we have to think about.
Really important topic for us to think about, both globally and locally, water. My guests have been Dr. Norman Stoller, immediate past president of the American Water Resources Association National Capital Section, and Dr. Talessa Dexisa, director of the Water Resources Research Institute and the Environmental Testing Laboratory here at the University of the District of Columbia. And the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia is committed to improving the economic opportunity and quality of life of people and communities here in Washington, D.C. Our study and research not only take place in classrooms, laboratories, and architecture studios, but you will find us in community gardens, schools, parks, and at farmers markets all over the District of Columbia. If you would like more information about our academic programs or about our workforce development certificates, workshops, and soil and water testing services, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. Thank you for joining me on Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. I am Sabina O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.